Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
All right, so I'm Jeff Myers, as Eileen mentioned, and I moved to Somerville about 5 years ago, and I bought my first house in Somerville, and I was very excited. I really wanted to connect with the community that I moved to, so one way I really connect with a place is to examine the history and particularly the images of the past and put that in the context of today and look at the changes, what has changed, what hasn't changed. And in doing so, I stumbled upon, doing some research on Somerville, I stumbled upon two remarkable books. The first is Somerville Past and Present, which I have a copy here. This was published by Samuels and Kimball in 1897, and it was a celebration of the 25th anniversary of the founding of the city of Somerville. And this book contains hundreds of images of the city taken at 1897 or before, and is really a fantastic artifact of the history of the Somerville, the names, the people, the settlers, prominent businessmen, everybody who is involved with the city at that time. Additionally, I found this Somerville book, which is more of a pamphlet. It was put together by the Edison Electric Illuminating Company, and this was sort of a more of a graphic advertisement about the city of Somerville that was put by the company to encourage people to move to Somerville. And so it's just sort of an advertising of the features and the history of Somerville, and again, contain many images of the city. So I wanted to start out really briefly and talk about the process of putting together this project once I found these two books. So starting with the fact that both of these books had been digitized and made freely accessible on the internet by an organization called the Internet Archive. This is a nonprofit organization that goes to the great libraries of the world and grabs all of the books that are in the public domain that are no longer in copyright, scans and digitizes and makes it accessible for free to the whole world. And so this project would not have been possible without this organization doing this great work, because they went to the Boston Public Library, pulled these books off the shelf, scanned it, and made it available for me to use in this project. So this is what one of those images looks like from the book. So you can see there's text, the image is inline. So I went through and identified the pages with images that I was interested in, cropped them out, and that's what's the result of this presentation. I'm not sure how many people are familiar with the company wordmaps.com. They are on Massachusetts Avenue and near Porter Square. And they also have done a great service to nerds like me who want to do this sort of historical research online, because they have digitized hundreds and thousands of different maps and books of maps, including a pivotal one for this research, which was Somerville's 1895 Atlas, which goes into great detail of the state of the city of Somerville in 1895. And so this was a huge resource for primarily when a building no longer exists, and to be able to identify where it was and place it. And throughout the presentation, all the images I tried to match up as closely as possible to the original images, like the angle and all that sort of stuff. And so it was really important to have this resource to show where these buildings used to exist. So there will be many images from Word Maps throughout the presentation. And finally, Google. Google Maps is fantastic. Google Street View was critical to be able to, before I actually walked over and saw whether something was there or not, I was able to draw up Google Street View and take a walk up and down the streets trying to find buildings and all that sort of stuff. And so, yeah, a huge resource. The end result is I put it all into a spreadsheet to keep track of where everything was and whether I'd taken a picture or not, and created a map of the city of Somerville containing all the green points are all the features in this presentation that are still present, and all the red points are things that are no longer there. So we'll go through it based on that. And one more point is all the imagery in this presentation is going to be available for free online. So I'm going to have to, there's a lot in here and it's going to be hard to keep it to an hour. So I'm going to be moving very quickly through these images, but you can take a look to your heart's content once all the images are posted online. So I've arranged this talk sort of geographically. So starting out with rough areas and neighborhoods. So starting out with Davis Square and West Somerville. So, and one more thing, because there's so much content in this talk, it would be really helpful if people could hold questions to the end, because otherwise we won't get through them all. All right, so Davis Square. This is Davis Square in 1897. So we can notice some features that are still present. So the Medina building on the corner here has been cut down to two stories from three. And then we'll take a look and compare this to the modern day. So you can see one dramatic change in the city, both in Davis Square and in Union Square, is there's lots of talk about the development of Somerville and the density in particular. And the density that we're used to these days is actually not a reflection of the historical density. A good number of places in the city used to be far more dense than they are today. And when we talk about building four-story buildings or that sort of thing, that's actually a return to the norm of how the city was initially developed. So this is the factory of the Sprague and Hathaway Company. And this was a company that was focused on photography, very early photography company, and the reproduction of prints. If anybody recognizes this building, this is now the post office building in Davis Square. So we can take a look at the changes back and forth. And there was a little bit more ground floor retail type thing, a little bit changes in the windows on the back, but the structure is still the same. And so walking around the corner, it's really cool. When I went and took this photo, is on the other side, you can still see the Sprague and Hathaway company on the building. So one of the company's early successes is that they sent their photographers and photographed Abraham Lincoln. And that was one of the photographs that made the company's name as it was reprinted and shared around the country. So this is the image of Abraham Lincoln that the company produced. Many people in the audience may remember the Hotel Woodbridge, right on College Ave, have many memories of it, yep. Unfortunately, it was destroyed by a fire in the years 1979 and 1980, and so this is what's standing there currently. So this is an example of a word map image that shows the historical evidence of where the building is and the positioning, and that's how they reproduce the image. Now this one was interesting. This is just outside the heart of Davis Square on Park Avenue. And I was surprised that this church still stands, but it has been dramatically changed. So this image of the church, and from the same angle, this is the church today. So it has been converted into condos, and very little of the original church remains. There's a little bit of his religious imagery there, but other than that, if we go back, you can see the roof line of the building here matches the roof line here. And then this is the other roof line of the church. Now, something that hasn't changed nearly as much and is a fantastic example of historic preservation is the Charles H. Lockhart House on So here, and this is 1897, it's listed as 352 Elm Street, but now it's College Ave. So this is what it looks like today. By the way, all the imagery of the modern day, this project, I took the pictures in the spring of 2011. So there have been some dramatic changes in Somerville since 2011 as well. And I know that this house is undergoing some renovations currently. This is the residence of Frederick Stockwell on 9 Kidder Avenue. And you can see the types of changes that occurred as lots were subdivided and developed. Because in here you see that they had a lovely horse carriage barn here, and it's gone, but the building is intact. And the same story is here at the Charles Lowell House on Kidder Ave. They originally had quite a substantial yard and a barn on the side of the house, and now there's an apartment building there. And there's a better view of the house. Oh, my clicker is acting up a little bit. So this one is the start of a theme that will be repeated throughout the talk, is that the development of Somerville, there were a huge number of churches in Somerville at that in that period of time in the 1890s, and a lot of them are gone. So the first one is the new Day Street Congregational Church. This was on Day Street, just outside Davis Square. And right now, it is a parking lot. Yep. So you can see it's at the corner of Day and Herbert. And this is where, like, the parking lot where the Davis Square farmer's market goes on, just back there. I don't know the history of it. Yep. There were a great deal of fantastic train stations in the 1890s in Somerville, 1890s, 1900, turn of the 20th century. Somerville was really developed as a result of these train lines allowing people to commute into the city of Boston fairly well, along with the streetcar system. And there was a great deal of really handsome buildings that were constructed as the train stations. So this was the Somerville Highland Station on the Boston Main Railroad. And we can see this is what it looks like today from the same perspective. It's on the community path. So this is the community path. So if we look, here's where the train line ran, and the building was right here. But thankfully, when they built the community path, which is a fantastic resource, it's better to have a path than a railroad, in my opinion. But they put in a playground on Lexington Ave or Lexington Street, and they did a tribute to the Somerville Highland stations. It's a little bit hard to see in here, but this is the Somerville Highlands on the sign in the playground. Here's a postcard image of the same station. And very interestingly, when they took this down, I believe it was taken down in the 1940s, they took all the stones from this building and built the field house in Nathan Tufts Park by the Powder House. So that was the reuse of the building. Oh, to take it down? Oh, okay. Yep, that's reasonable. So this one was another fun find. This was from 1909, so you can see what Highland Avenue looked like at 1909. It's unpaved with the streetcar lines here. And these were new residences erected by C. Hazeltine near the Somerville Highland Station. This one was near and dear to my heart because it wasn't, I didn't have any context of what the street address or anything like that was, but so I was able to figure out the location by using Street View. And there it is, they're all still there. And the hints here were the windows on the building and the additional side window there, which is kind of unusual for that style of house in Somerville.
What street is that?
This is Highland Ave. It's Cedar. Cedar and Highland.
No, that's not Cedar.
I'm pretty sure. I could be wrong. Oh, Willow, that's what I'm thinking, Willow. Willow and Highland, yep. And staying in the same area, right near the Somerville Highland Station, was Highland Road, which is very unusual for Somerville in that it is was developed having this like park-like gap between the sidewalks and the actual road, and that's maintained today. So that's the same perspective now. If we go back and forth, you'll notice this house here is present in right here as well. So Bernard W. Lawrence lived in this house at 289 Highland Avenue. It has a very nice carriage house over there as well. Unfortunately, his house is no longer standing, and in its place is this apartment building, the corner of Highland and Cedar.
Jeremy, we've been looking for that picture.
Now we have it.
Jean Broome lived in that little house.
So, wow.
The carriage house in the back?
That was the apartment building went up when the church came down.
Yep.
That was a little church there. It was called
the Advent Church.
The Advent Church. And Jean Broome's family grew up in the little house in the back. Wow. And when he was doing his book, he kept looking for it, and you had it all.
I guess I had it. Sorry about that. We'll send it along. Next is Walter C. Menzer. He came to Somerville in 1872, and he served in the Somerville Fire Department as a call man. He was an alderman, the vice president of the West Somerville Cooperative Bank, and the director of the Somerville National Bank. And he lived on this house on Cherry Street, which has been very well preserved, and that's it today. So there was an addition put on. This was brought up to two stories, but other than that, the house looks pretty similar. All right, moving on to Spring Hill. Most famous residence in Spring Hill has to be the Roundhouse. So this was built by Enoch Robinson, born in Boston in 1801. He worked as a manufacturer of ship trimmings and ship steering apparatus, and then in the hardware business, making doorknobs and locks. He moved to Somerville in 1847, and when Spring Hill was nothing but a pasture, and in 1856 he erected the celebrated roundhouse. The house, in its perfectly circular in form, is probably the only building of its kind used as a residence in this portion of the country, and I think that's still true today. So this is what it looks like in 2011. It's been undergoing a renovation for quite a number of years. There has been progress made, but it still looks fairly similar to this day. But we're still hoping that it will come back to its former glory. So this was an apartment block on Highland Ave, and this picture in particular I was interested in because it shows the cobblestones that they were using to actually pave Highland Ave. And it's also interesting because it's an example of the mixed-use development that we're trying to bring back into the city, where there is storefronts on the first floor and then residences above. And comparing that today, it looks very similar, but the stores are gone. So just if people don't recognize this, if people know where Three Little Figs, this is directly across the street from Three Little Figs. And then just a neighbor around the corner here is St. Catherick's Roman Catholic Church. This is a photograph from 1909, and this, thankfully, it looks just as fantastic today. The same cannot be said for the First Baptist Church, which was just around the corner on Belmont Street. This was in Spring Hill, just around the corner from the Roman Catholic Church, and this is what it looks like today. Parking lot. So, yeah, if you're familiar with the park on Belmont, it was right across the street from the park on Belmont. This is the residence of William Wadley, 135 Highland Ave. This probably will be familiar to a bunch of people, but in 1897, he had lived in this property for nearly 20 years. The book noted that he takes a great interest in the public matters pertaining to the welfare of the city, but has always declined an office of any kind. He has one of the most pleasantest homes in the city, and being of rather domestic tastes, prefers it to the social and club life. I don't blame him. It's a nice house. And that's what it looks like today. And this is, I believe this has won a preservation award, and you can see how much of the details has remained, like the curls at the top of the windows and the dentifice, I think is that the term, at the top there. Dentum. This is Benjamin Lovejoy. I just love this picture because of the awesome beard this guy has. Oh, so Benjamin Lovejoy lived at this lovely house, also on Highland Ave. He was owner of Cyrus Carpenter and Company, which dealt in furnaces. He was a member of the Common Council, serving on the committees of public property, fuel, and streetlights. He was one of the foremost promoters of the park, which I think means the Central Hill Park, and has been very interested in forwarding its interests. Unfortunately, his home no longer stands and is now a... It's a daycare or a preschool. Yeah. The house next door still stands and is remarkable, but unfortunately I don't have a photograph of it historically. Okay, so we're getting to the story of Charles H. Bradshaw. So he's really remarkable in terms of what I was able to research, in that he is the developer of Westwood Road. So in 1894, he worked with the Benton farm to combine the land of an old estate of Honorable James M. Shute and the Benton farm to start producing the homes along Westwood Road. So the first thing that he did was he moved the mansion house where it was previously located. I haven't figured this out, but now it is on Summer Street. It's a little difficult to see the house in this angle, so here's another picture of it a little bit clearer. And then once the house was moved, he laid out Westwood Road using the most modern of road construction techniques. I'm quoting, so it's obviously not the most modern of techniques at this day. Bradshaw then built the homes of Westwood Road with the latest designs, each entirely different from the others, while all built with the closest regard to their juxtaposition. Mr. Bradshaw has found an immediate sale for them almost as soon as they were started and months before their completion. In the winter of 1895, Bradshaw made the unusual choice to move the largest trees from the estate on the existing property, 50 and 60-year-old elms and maples, to the street line of the lots. By the following summer, the two-year-old road was shaded by 50-year-old trees. This sort of undertaking was the first in Massachusetts. So these were very, very substantial trees, and it was a very unique undertaking to move them.
Jeff, I don't think this is the house that was moved. This house, I think the Bradshaw house, was built in place, but the Shute house was moved to the side of Westwood Road, so about halfway up.
Oh, okay.
It's an Italian house, which is...
Oh, the one that was just repainted, the yellow one? Yep, okay, that makes sense. So we're going to take a quick tour down Westwood Road, starting at the corner right across the street here from the residence of J.F. Barry. So this looks remarkably the same as it did when it was built. And then these are the rest of the houses on Westwood Road that were featured in the book. So this one, it's right next door to the museum. This one is quite remarkable. I love the tower that is maintained today. This one is near and dear to one of our audience members. This is very lovely today. This one was just recently for sale and got to take a tour of it, which was fantastic. It's been repainted since the time this picture was taken. Okay, so that was Westwood Road. Moving on to the Emmanuel Episcopal Church. This was at the corner of Summer and Central, but unfortunately no longer stands, and the apartment building stands there now. If we go back and forth, you can see the house here on the right with the turret there is the same one that's there. So this also establishes a pattern of the way the development of Somerville has gone, is that very frequently, whenever you see an apartment building such as this, there used to be a church there. And the main reason for that is that when the churches are taken down, it's the only lot that's sizable enough to put up an apartment building, rather than having to accumulate separate lots together to put up a building. So this is Edward Cox. He lived at 36 Central Street, which still stands. It has lost some of its detail to vinyl siding, unfortunately, but it's still there and it can still be restored. This is the residence of Abraham A. Elston at 25 Preston, which also has really lovely detail work and shutters and all that, which unfortunately has been a little bit obscured by siding. But the structure still stands and it can be restored. It says the Honorable Edward Glines, who was born in Somerville in 1849. He was a trader of tea, coffee, and spices, and then he started trading in politics. He was elected to the State House of Representatives and the State Senate in 1886 and then retired in 1888. So this was his house. Again, absolutely gorgeous woodwork and trim and everything, and nice little horse over there, or pony. And this is the house today on Highland Ave. Probably.
It's actually been, they built a big extension into the back of it, mm-hmm. So it's actually been completely redone.
Oh, great. That's very good to hear. Okay, and the Derby Desk Company. It was founded on January 1st, 1881 by George Derby and Frederick Kilmer. And this present building was built in January of 1895. So this is the 1909 image. And this is remarkable for having an image of the Somerville Junction Station in the front as well. So if you are familiar with the Somerville Junction Park, that's where the area where the station is now. So this is it today. And if you look closely at the tower, you can still see the original lettering of the Derby Desk Company up there. It's on Central Street and Vernon? Yeah, the Vernon Street Studios are in the building now. And everybody knows the good old armory. Again, this is interesting because you can see all the cobblestones that are going to be laid out on Highland Avenue in this photograph. And this was the armory in 2011. Another fine example of preservation at work. All right, moving on to the areas of Highland Ave, Central Hill, and Gilman Square. So first off, the Winter Hill Station. This is an interesting image because you can see in the background the high school, the library, and City Hall up the hill from the station. Here's another image from 1909. And this was 2011. Yeah. So thankfully, we should be getting eventually some changes to this area yet again, and we'll have the Green Line station going into that location.
I think they were saying that back in 1909.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. Sounds about right. This is the Knights of Malta and the Masonic buildings in Gilman Square, and people will probably recognize this image as well, because one of the buildings are there, but the other one is a parking lot. So thankfully, this building still stands, has this fantastic relief up at the top, and is primed for restoration and preservation. The Citizen Building was on the corner of Pearl Street and Medford Street. The Somerville Citizen was a weekly newspaper established in 1888. This building was built in the summer of 1890, and the original plan for by the owners was only a 1.5-story building, but there were such demand for offices and businesses in the building that this larger building was erected. Unfortunately, it no longer stands, and right now there's a small park at that corner. So this is the corner of Medford coming this way and Pearl coming that way. Now, moving back into happier territory, the several modern apartment homes in Somerville. This is a 1909 image. And this is on Highland Avenue, right across from the library. And it still stands and is looking pretty much the same. The same can be said for the residence of Dr. Osgood at 6 Highland Avenue, which is right near the corner of Highland and Medford. And I was able to snap this picture in 2011, shortly after the restoration, and there it is today. Same can't be said for the Central Fire Station, alas. That was at the Highland Ave and Medford Street. So this was a sketch that was included in the book in 1897, and then a photograph in 1909. You can see the streetcar lines. Going, probably making the turn from Medford Street to Highland Ave there. And that is what's there today.
Do you know why they have the high towers?
I don't.
To hang the hoses.
To dry the hoses out.
Oh, I thought you meant in this building. Yeah. And that's a postcard image of the same building as well. The residence of George F. Loring on 78 Highland Avenue. So George F. Loring was a prominent architect. He was the founder of the firm Loring and Phipps, and he designed many homes in Somerville and the public library, the Odd Fellows Building, Masonic Building, Divinity Hall and Tufts College, and the Gline and Pope Schools. So he was a very prominent architect. And he built his home directly across one of the street from one of his greatest works, which was the original Somerville Public Library. So the house still stands. It's in a little bit of a rough shape in 2011.
And still.
This, yeah, he moved.
He moved next door and built that house.
Oh.
And then that's when he
got fed up.
And they tore down the library.
So this was the library.
Yes.
Yep. So, yep. So,
he sold his house,
and thankfully, the front door of the library is the door that I'm standing in front of, right here.
And also the concrete balusters outside and the wrought iron railing—that's all in the front.
Oh, fantastic. So, moving on to Union Square and Prospect Hill. Here's Union Square, and I believe this is the 1909 image. And this is going back to that theme from Davis Square of the density being far different than Union Square today. So if we compare that to today. So this building is the same building, it just lost 2 stories. It's cut off there. And then you see that the building here used to be a 3-story building, and now it's just a single story. So it's worth thinking about as Union Square develops that this might be a reasonable density to go back to. So people are probably familiar with the old police station on Bow Street. So here's 1897 and 1909. And it has been converted into condos on Bow Street very, very nicely. I think that's another Preservation Award winner.
The roof was entirely removed at one point, and the roof that you see in the modern pictures is a reconstruction.
Yep. Yeah, it's gorgeous. The same story goes for the First Methodist Episcopal Church at the corner of Bow and Wesley Park. At some point, it lost the majority of its tower. And this is what it looks like today. And it's been converted into condos as well, which is far more preferable than tearing it down, thankfully. The Prospect Hill Congregational Church, however, is still functioning as a church and looks almost exactly the same today.
That's condos.
That is condos, too? Yeah. Oh, sorry about that. And you can see the corner of the Somerville National Bank in this photo here, in the same corner here. Speaking of the Somerville National Bank, it opened in 1892, and Quincy A. Vinyl, the namesake of Vinyl Street, was president, and it's currently Block 11. It was the building here was built in 1908. The Roman arch and the arch and the Roman grill here, unfortunately, were removed in renovations around 1980. So this is what Block 11 looks like today.
Interesting, in the old photo, the shop next door says tea and coffee in the window.
Oh, yeah. Didn't move far. Yeah. But and to me, this was a really remarkable, again, photo showing the original density and comparing this building to the Goodyear building that's there now. And St. Joseph's, and very prominent right in the heart of Union Square, lost its steeple, I think, in the 50s from a hurricane, if I recall correctly. 38, yeah. But other than that, it's in really great shape. Sorry for jumping ahead. The Somerville Journal was first published in 1870, and the journal building here opened in July of 1894. The book noted that the journal's equipment is one of the most extensive in New England outside of Boston. Occupying three floors of a large brick building, it has all the appliances necessary for carrying on a great newspaper and job printing establishment. At this time, the journal employed 50 people to run its operations. So that's it today. This is on Walnut Street, just outside Union Square. Walnut Street. So I forget the current use. Is it studios or residences, I think? Yeah. Union Square Presbyterian Church was quite a handsome building on Warren Ave. Unfortunately, it no longer stands. A very large apartment building is there now. And there it was, on the corner with Sanborn. The same goes for the residence of Richard Sturtevant, 31 Walnut Street. Gorgeous house, beautiful carriage house in the back as well. Alas, that's gone as well, and another apartment building there. Aaron H. Gould was a carpenter by trade, born in Nova Scotia, and built several municipal buildings in Somerville and beyond. The city stables and the central fire station, which we saw earlier, was built by Gould. So this is a sketch of the building in 1897. And it looks very similar today. It's lost some of the details, like the side entrance. I think this window is there, and the diamond up there is still present there. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
This might be the building next door, though. It's hard to tell in the sketch. And then the Louisville Niles house at 45 Walnut is another fantastic example of preservation, and that in 2011 at least, it was nearly as gorgeous as it was back in the day. And the same goes for the house, well, slightly less so, but still impressive, is the residence of Robert Wright at 11 Summit Ave. Particularly noteworthy is, watch the porches on both levels as they go to that. So the rounded tops here are here, and this is maintained as well. And then, of course, the Prospect Hill Tower. I threw this in because I thought it was noteworthy that this shows the tower from an unusual angle prior to the construction of the wall at the base, which is shown there. So Winter Hill. So this is a great photograph along Broadway in 1909. This is near the corner of Sycamore Street, and three out of the four houses made it. So that's it today. So these are still absolutely gorgeous buildings.
And the one on the left, the one on the left, they're preserved.
Yeah, the one on the left, they've done a ton of work on.
Oh, yeah,
it's beautiful.
Fantastic.
Much better looking now. They restored it back to where it was.
Fantastic. Yeah. And the Winter Hill Congregational Church is another fine example of preservation. A corner of Broadway and Central. Here it is in 1897 and 1909. And that's it today. The residence of Charles B. Sanborn at Adams Street also still stands, but notice the changes in the building, like in the massive amount of windows and the detailing in the roof line and the fireplace, as well as the carriage house on the left. Carriage house still stands. It's a little bit less fancy, but and the windows as well.
That's condos now.
Yep. George A. Macomber lived at 102 Thurston Street, and his house still stands. It's a little bit different from this angle. It's hard to see with the shrubs, but it's the same house. Charles A. Grimmins, let's see, nope, I don't have anything about him, lived at 72 Thurston Street. And this is another dramatic type of transformation, but it's still there. You see, and the residence of Lyman B. Rich, 381 Medford Street. Rich was born in Truro, Mass, on the Cape in 1834, and he became a sea captain at the age of 18. He voyaged to various ports, terminating with a trip to the Mediterranean and South America. He retired from life on the ocean in 1878, and he has been engaged in the ship brokerage business and steamboat agency since then. And that's it today. So it's, it still has the unusual, like, angled corner on the house.
It's got, there's a bunch of stones up in that little triangle with the date on it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's 1890-something. It's a small town, right?
Yeah. Very cool. So this was the Broadway Congregational Church in Sycamore Street. Unfortunately, I think this one no longer stands, in another apartment building. And the same goes for the Winter Hill Baptist Church. It's no longer the Winter Hill Baptist Church, but it is still religiously affiliated. This is it today. Yeah, I believe it was torn down and built anew. But And the Winter Hill Universalist Church at the corner of Thurston and Evergreen, this is one of the more dramatic transitions in the presentation, going from this lovely church to the City Hall Annex.
If I'm not mistaken, that was originally a nursing
home. A nursing home, yeah, wow. So now we're going to start a section on grand homes of Broadway that no longer exist. So this is the residence of William Mercer in 1897, which is now the Winter Hill Bank. And the residence of Dr. G.W.W. Whiting, who came to Somerville in 1891 and was a practicing physician at the Somerville Hospital. That's it today. So, the Oddfellows Building might be familiar to some people. It was burnt down in 1974. It was a great building. It was built by Loring that we mentioned earlier.
It also had a movie theater.
It had a movie theater, yep. And it's now the Broadway Health Center. Stephen W. Filler lived in this house on Walnut Street. And this is a great example of a building that really still stands, but I'm not sure if it's been restored at this point, but it is very nice, the amount of detail that's still there, and it could really use some preservation. Okay, finally, wrapping up in East Somerville. So the building of the Columbia Associates on Broadway, this building, it might look familiar to people. It's very well represented today. Pretty much all the detailing is still there. And the residence of Nathan H. Reed on Pearl Street, this building still stands as well. It's a little hard to see with this big tree, but it's still present there. Yep. It still has this neat window in the roof line.
That tree wasn't
obscure. Tree didn't obscure it so much. Look how gorgeous this house was. Just count the number of windows. Like, I don't think it's possible to squeeze another window in this house. 31 Pearl Street. It still stands, but unfortunately, it doesn't quite look the same. But it's still has a lot of potential. This is another dramatic transformation. The Prospect Hill Station, another of the fine stations of the Boston and Maine Railroad, today. So this isn't exactly fair because this is on Alston Street. There's a line of very substantial buildings along the railroad. So technically I was supposed to take the photo from this side, but this also has a significant number of buildings on it. But I thought that was kind of cute. This is a very dramatic change as well. It was barely recognizable to me when I went over and took a look, but the First Universalist Church at the corner of Cross and Tufts it still stands, but it had quite the transformation, and that's what it is today.
Another
one here. Yeah. Oh, yep. But no, you can't very well see it from this photograph, but if you walk just down the street a little bit, you can still see the remnants of the original church. The First Orthodox Congregational Church on Franklin opposite Perkins. Another apartment building. Uh, And the same goes for East Somerville Baptist Church. This one's slightly different. Perkins Street opposite Pickney is now two apartment buildings. Yeah, so this one is another remarkable case for preservation. If the community desires, the Randall Memorial Free Baptist Church in 1897 was in the process of being built. So this is a sketch of the building, and it's on Cross Street in East Somerville and is in really desperate need of some help. So it's been condemned. You can see the cornerstone. Still saying that it's 1896. So, yeah, it's a beautiful building, and it would be great to find a reuse for it. The residence of Amy Giro on Pearl Street still stands. This is another case where the original building was quite handsome, and there's been some dramatic changes, but you can still see the resemblance there. Oop. So that's it today. So we go back and forth. Ah, sorry, clicker issues. Yeah, yeah, it's it to today. Yeah. And then finally, the residence of George Poole on Mount Vernon Street is a really great example of preservation in East Somerville. Pay attention to the porch here. I thought that was quite remarkable that still stands today. Yeah, it's a gorgeous house. All right, so that's what I've got to show today. I've got many more images. So I want to say a quick thanks to the Internet Archive, Word Maps, and Google, without which this project would totally have not been possible, at least under my amateurish means. And also, a huge thank you to the Historic Somerville and the Somerville Museum for allowing me to present this work. So all the images are going to be available online, not quite yet, but we'll send out notifications of this URL, post it to Facebook, all that sort of stuff. So you can go back and revisit them and look at them in high resolution, great detail, and all that sort of stuff. And since the original images that I took were made under the public domain and freely available, I wanted to do the same for this project going forward. So this is all licensed under a Creative Commons license, meaning that anybody can reuse it as needed so long as it's attributed. So thank you very much.